So last time you guys had traveled to Nortek via magical Ixen house. You guys did some exploring. Some artifacts were sold. Some armor was exchanged for favors. Hwinnil did some sneaking around at the Black. I think it's Black Tomb. I gotta get by notes. All the notes. Trade ward warehouse. Yeah, you had Kevmorn has to go to the Iron Tomb to place an offering and for a merchant whose ancestor was a paladin of Morden. There was also the Black Crypt where Hwinnil was sneaking around and saw two very suspicious individuals go into and have a muffled chat. There was also Kasov who went to the library and had a the Temple of Ioun and had a very nice chat with the high priest. I'm getting my things messed up. And yeah, it was, and pretty much Forgrin acted as your tour guide since he has had a lot of time in Nortek, even though he's not here again today. That's fine. So what did you guys want to, Ramas, you were headed to the Pilgrimer and Gauntlet, or that was one of your destinations that you wanted to stop at eventually, I think.
That's where I wanted to go to.
Which one's the Pilgrimer and Gauntlet? I'm drawing a blank.
The Pilgrim and Gauntlet was where One Hand told you she would send a message to eventually to get some more info on Zaylor Steelforge.
Right.
It is a headquarters for the treasure hunters in Ironfast.
Right. Okay. Yes, I'd like to go there.
Alright. For simplicity's sake, we could just say, I mean, you guys were all talking together last time in a group. Did you want to go alone, Ramas? Did you want to bring anybody with you?
I mean, does anybody want to come with me?
Good question. Where,
I was going to say, where? What, like,
a den of thieves. The treasure hunter headquarters.
Oh, a den of thieves. Yeah, right. I'll go.
Of course I'll go. Of course.
You have, and I fear my mere presence will
really class up the joint.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. You know it.
Yep. Yeah. So I'll go too because our quest takes us there. But I'll talk to Ramas. I'll say to Ramas, you think that based on what you know about these kinds of places, do you think that it's all right for me to come along?
Sure.
Okay.
We don't judge.
Okay.
I do.
Yeah, but you're a paladin.
Yeah, it's like it's literally my job description.
It's pretty much your job, yep.
Yeah.
All right.
No killing people.
Well, nice. I wouldn't. I'm offended.
Okay. Right, well, I'll join you guys because our quest takes us there.
Yeah, I'll head over.
All right. Following some of the directions you have picked up, you eventually go through a few alleyways and make your way to the Pilgrim Gauntlet. It's in the seedier part of town. It is definitely, the appearance of it looks like it's a rundown. Two-floor in. There are a couple wooden boards over a couple of the windows because there has been glass that has been smashed, and instead of just repairing the window, they decided, hey, let's put a board in front of it instead. There is a very faded painting of what looks like a refugee or some kind of religious wanderer with a goblet in hand. There are a couple beggars around the building. just, you know, begging for alms, and there's, you know, knocked over cans of refuse around one side of the building, and the roof looks like it's, there might be a couple holes in the top of it. You're not sure from this angle. It definitely looks like it's in disrepair, like very heavy disrepair. It doesn't look like a very nice inn at all.
Perfect.
What time of day is it?
It's probably around, you guys did a lot of exploring during the morning, so it's probably around evening at this point. You guys had been to the trade ward and, you know, got some things. You talked to your friend at the Temple of Ioun, so it's getting a little late. I'd say around maybe 4 or 5-ish at this point. So you're all standing in front.
I will go in.
All right. Ramas, when you enter the establishment, there are a few... This inn looks like it is populated with mostly dwarves. You do see one or two humans inside. Most, you know, it's a nice atmosphere. I mean, there are people talking. It's pretty low lit in here. Probably because most of the majority of the customers are dwarves, so light doesn't really bother them too much. I mean, there is a nice roaring fireplace on the far end of the inn, and currently there is, other than some of the waitstaff, there are two bartenders. You see a large woman, probably in her middle-aged dwarven years. She has nearly all of her hair is gray at this point. Very stocky, has a couple whiskers on her chin, and she's just currently speaking to one of the customers at the end of the bar. The other dwarf that is attending the bar is male, a little bit younger, probably 30-ish equivalent of how old dwarves are, because dwarves live for about, if I'm not mistaken, around 250 years in comparison to everyone else. I know it's maybe twice as long as humans. I just want to double check because, yeah. All right, 200. Yep. Yeah. So probably 60-ish in dwarven years. Nearly all, you know, bald. Doesn't have a beard, which is it's really weird for a dwarf in, you know, dwarven culture, but, you know, he is currently just cleaning a countertop, not really paying attention to any of the conversations happening in his vicinity.
I'll go over to him.
All right. Kasov, Kevmorn, are you guys doing anything?
I just sort of looked at Kasov and be like, so, nice place.
Yeah, I'm just looking around.
It smells faintly of stale vomit and urine.
Well, based on that, I'll casually try to follow Ramas at a distance, but mostly just keep my focus on him.
Okay. All right, so you want to talk to the guy. All right, so Ramas,
yes.
He, you know, doesn't really look up as he doesn't look up when you approach. He still continues to clean the countertop.
Hi.
And when he looks up, there are slight bags under his eyes now that you have a closer look at him. And in a gruff voice, he's like, "What do you want?"
Letter.
Pardon?
I'll like subtly flash my treasure hunter insignia at him. A letter for me.
You'll probably want to go around the back. He starts signing in just so you can see. He starts signing in Thieves Can't. In the back.
My people.
Move the sacks at the back of the room. You'll get to where you need to go.
Okay.
By the way, the names, if you're going to be back again, the name's Rack Foe Spear, just so you know.
I'll sign him thank you and my name.
All right.
I'll turn to... I don't think I should take Kevmorn and Kasov into the Den of Thieves. That seems like a bad idea.
What are you talking about? I could
unless you desperately need to go into the Den of Thieves.
I'll say, all right, we can hang back, and I'll look around for an empty table to sit at.
There are a few. There's one in the corner, one in one of the far corners of the room. There's one close to the fireplace, and there is one close to the bar.
I'll go to the... How dark is the corner?
it's fairly dim. There are a couple people whose facial features are near corners like that one that you can't really see their facial expressions. They're talking in low voices. It's far enough away where you probably won't be spotted if anybody was trying to find you or something like that.
I understand.
You should totally go talk to them. They're mysterious. They're mysterious.
Yes,
corner of the tavern.
Mysterious. Don't figure in a. They must be a quest giver or something.
Exactly. They have to have something good.
I'll follow your lead on this and go sit in the corner.
Yeah, okay. Oh, you've become the mysterious stranger in the corner.
We are.
And then a group of adventurers comes in and says, oh, hey, look, a strange person. No.
Two holy men in the corner of a bar.
Yep.
Two holy
bad
men
joke
in the corner.
Yeah.
Yes.
Bad joke coming or something.
Yes, that's right. A paladin and a cleric sit down in a...
walk into a bar.
That's us.
Yep, that's
everybody
you.
Dies because of Ramas.
Hey, now let's not get too hasty. Only some of them might die.
All right.
Yes. So maybe even no one will.
So anyways, yes, I'll sit down in the corner.
Yes.
All right. So Ramas, where you had?
I will sneakily move the sacks and get into the back.
All right. When you go into the back, there are a couple, a dwarven couple, two younger dwarves currently manning the kitchen. They don't really notice, they don't really take notice to you as you walk into the back. This seems to be very standard fare for them, especially since you look kind of sneaky and the like-minded that would come to a place like this. You move some sacks, which are, you would think they were really heavy. They're very light. They just have the appearance of something heavy being filled up in them. And when you move the sacks to the side, there is a trap door at the bottom of the sack.
Okay. I will go through the trap door.
Okay. You go through the trap door. It leads into nearly near darkness, and it is a winding 30-foot tunnel that descends on a just a steady decline. And when you get to the end of the tunnel, there are two individuals, a dwarven male, and what looks like to be a halfling female, and they're just sitting in front of a tunnel, just conversing with each other at a small a small table with a couple cards on it and the two flasks of what appears to be ale. They both look up at you as you descend down the tunnel.
Hi!
The female halfling kind of cocks her head to the side and says, "Hi, are you lost, or are you...
You have a letter for me.
You probably want to talk to, the boss, but first can you..." And she, you know, she motions to, you know, she opens her coat and there's, like, she flashes a badge to you. A badge, not...
I didn't even hear it as that. I'm just, like, imagining groups of thieves opening up and, like, flashing badges at each other.
I just like the fact Ramas is going up to every individual and just be like, you have a letter for me. And, like, he's just going to work his way around the entire room before he gets to the person who will actually give it him.
Probably. I will thieves cant at her. Where's the boss?
Yeah, she points to a... door behind her.
I will thieves cant at her, thank you. And go to the door.
Alright, they let you. They give you a weird look as you walk by, but like shrug and go back to their conversation. After you enter through the door, it opens up into a very large common area. There look like there are benches, a couple pieces of art on the walls. Everything is made out of granite here. Well, besides the furniture. The walls are granite. Most of there are nice alcoves in the granite. There are a couple shrines to particular deities, those associated with thieving and luck, mostly. And there are a couple people meandering about, some in conversation. You overhear a couple people talk about particular jobs they just completed or particular contracts that they're about to take on. Was there anybody you wanted to... What did you want to do? I mean, you're in a large common area. There are entranceway... Well, there are doorways... to the north, south. No. The north is where you came from. East, west, and south in this common area.
Ramas, visibly a little bothered, is just going to shout, "Someone has a letter for me! Who is it?"
At this point, everybody stops talking, turns, looks at you... very confused, and a younger dwarf woman steps up, black hair, green eyes, simple leather armor, and she says, who are you?"
"I'm Ramas."
Ramas, I mean, do you know... You know what? Just come with me.
I'm the boss.
Oh, you're looking for Dragonbender. All right, come with me.
His name is Dragonbender?
His last name is Dragonbender.
Wow, that's a fake name if I've ever heard one.
It isn't.
Well, you don't know. She leads you through the eastern entrance. You go past what looks like to be a large training area with a couple wooden dummies, a small sand pit. There are a couple... They don't appear to be thieve-ish. They look like, you know, very large... individuals, one human, one half, are currently, you know, doing some training with the dummies. One is actually in a splint mail armor. The other individual, who is a half-orc, is currently in just a pair of furred boots and burlap pants with a giant greatsword, currently in the middle of cleaving a wooden dummy in half. She takes you past the training area through a small hallway, which has a couple of rooms to the left and right of you. And at the end of the hallway, there is a simple white oaken door. She wraps her hands on the door, and there is a voice from behind the door that says, "What is it?" And the female dwarf says, "Bardar, there's somebody here to see you." The door opens, and out comes this dwarf, eye patch on his left eye, wearing a blue bandana. And a few steps you do see him take. He seems to favor his right leg. Dressed in just simple clothing. There's a little soot on his face. And he eyes you, Ramas, with a kind of, you know, trying to give you a look up and down. And he says, "What can I do for you?"
"You're supposed to have a letter for me from the boss."
What's your boss's name?
One Hand?
Oh, you... Gimda, I got this. And the dwarven woman nods and says, "All right." She kind of shakes her head as she leaves. I do have a letter for you, actually. It came not too long ago. It's really quick. Come inside. We'll want to talk for a bit."
"Okay."
Kasov, you and Kevmorn are sitting at your table when just sitting, chatting, a waitress comes up to your table. A very young woman with brown hair. And a very dirty apron, and with a bright smile, she says, "Hello, welcome to the Pilgrim and Gauntlet. I am Renla. I will be your server for tonight. Is there anything I can get you?"
What's good here?
Please, come on.
Just with the eyes, it's sort of like a, "Come on, you know there's nothing good here," sort of thing. No verbal, but it's just all in the eyes.
Yep, and don't forget I have a -2 to my charisma.
So. I've got a +2, so balance is out.
This can only go good places.
Yeah, you sweet talker, but...
Well, I got the grip. Well, it depends on what you want. Tonight we have some shepherd's pie, some smoked pork, pickled sausage. Most of these will come, if you wished, with pickled beets or steamed carrots. If you want a drink, wine, we have wine, spirits, ale, lager. It just depends on if you want the house ale or not. I mean, what are you gentlemen feeling up for tonight?
I think the shepherd's pie sounds appetizing.
All right.
So go with that and an ale. What would you like, Kevmorn?
I'll just have the wine.
All right. All right. So just 5 copper.
Oh, that's fine.
Okay, so 1 table wine, 1 ale, and 1 shepherd's pie. Are you sure you don't want anything to eat, sir?
I'll just have the whole bottle of wine.
Okay, that'll bring the price up to 2 silver?
I'm still good, I'll have that.
Okay, alright. I'll be right back with your order. And she darts back towards the bar into the kitchen.
It's a liquid diet.
Nice.
So you guys are hanging about. Roll a perception check, both of you.
Oh no.
Alright, so you are too engrossed in the light conversation that you are currently having. So while you're talking, about 10, maybe 15 minutes later, and it's very obvious because you can't quite get away from the sound, there is the screeching of a lute being played. When you look over to where the sound is coming from, you see that there is this very small person. But when your eyes adjust to the light next to the fire, you don't see that it's a person per se. It's a person, but your eyes seem to be treating tricks on you because it looks like there is a kobold with a lute in front of a fireplace currently.
I'm going insane. This is what Ramas does to people.
Yeah.
You see that, right?
It's a little odd, but alright, well, it's one of those kinds of places. I'm going to try to act like I don't care.
Okay.
Role performance.
Actually, that's what he's doing. Oh, wow. So you see the kobold, as you try to ignore him, and perform some, warm-up voice exercises, like Dory, me, 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 and starts going into a song, which the song isn't bad. It's, the rhythm, his lute playing skills are good. However, the song seems very, very simple because the only word he's saying is doom. He's going doom, 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 doom. Along with the playing's fine. It's just this song seems to only have one word. A couple of patrons kind of look oddly in his direction, but to go back to whatever conversation or food they're partaking currently. About 5-10 minutes later, your waitress comes back with your order and sets it very, gently in front of you. And Ranla looks over to the fireplace. It's like, Deacon's not off key for once. Amazing. And goes back to before she leaves, she's like, well, is there anything else I can get you in the meantime, or are you think you're good for now?
I'm fine.
Yeah, I'm fine. So this
good.
This musician, he's here often.
He's been here for about a week. Gimya and Rack, he asked if he could have, if it's okay for him to perform at the inn for a little bit, and they were fine with it. I mean, very rare that we get kobolds around here, especially nuns are very nice and polite, but he hasn't caused any trouble, though his song might start annoying some of the customers. Usually it goes on for about... This particular song, his only song, usually goes on for about 30 minutes.
That's okay. Okay, well. Live music always makes an inn more appealing, I say, kind of implying that the inn is not very nice.
she looks like, don't worry about it. But, if you need anything, just wave me over, and yeah. And she goes back to serving other tables. Ramas, You are brought into Dydar's Dragonbender's office, which is sparsely, very minimalistic. There is not too much in here, just a table, well, a desk, a chair, a small shelving unit for a couple of books, it looks like, and a liquor cabinet, and a very nice, the thing that stands out about this particular office is there is a very large tooth that sits on his table. The bottom of it is, you know, part of the tooth is covered in like a gold band. It looks like it acts as more of a paperweight for a bunch of the documents that he currently is looking through. A couple maps are scattered on his table. And he says, yeah, one hand sent you a message. You wanted everything we could dig up on Zaylor Steelforge, if I'm correct. Right?
That's the guy.
All right. Well, we do have a dossier on him. He's been the subject, well, his clan has been the subject of multiple contracts. The source and the target of. You're not dealing with a very pleasant guy, I hope you're realizing, right?
Yes.
Alright.
Yes.
Well, he says, well, is there anything in particular that you needed information about him? I mean, he points over to a small stack of papers on his desk. We have a lot on his family background. They're mainly merchants. Most of them keep their nose clean, except for a few choice individuals, Xanlor being one of them. There have been rumors of him doing trade with slavers from the West. Not usually looked very well upon, but it does bring in a lot of money, knowing how valued slaves are on the Western continent. He does have a home here. It is located in the trade ward in one of the residential districts there. Was there anything in particular that you wanted to know about him? I mean, we have a lot of info on him in particular.
I'll tell him all about the stuff that we found at his house in,
Okay.
Found all those lovely kids who he had decided to play with.
Yeah, you see Dydar's, facial expressions grimace, and he motions you to sit across from him, at his desk. He goes over to his liquor cabinet, and as he's going over, he says, this is going to be a long conversation then. He brings out a bottle of a light brass-colored liquid, takes two small glasses, puts them on the table, fills them with a couple large chunks of ice that he gets from underneath the cabinet. Sets it on the table. Sets some peanuts as well onto the table. And he says, this is going to be a very long conversation then. It appears that we know that Zaylor does partake in blood rituals. How do you feel about vigilante justice? Ramas.
It's useful sometimes.
Okay. Well, because of the issues you know about Zaylor, we've actually gotten a couple contracts on him. A couple contracts on his life.
Oh. Now,
yeah. There are a few very noble clans members in Nortek that don't want him around anymore. Actually, including a couple people from his own family. Name in Nortek, he starts explaining a little bit about Dwarven culture. Your reputation is held very high in Nortek, and the Steelforge are not, they're a lower class of nobles, but they still regard their reputation as something that is very valued. And somebody like Zaylor will stain that reputation. Now, ranging from the contracts that I have, there's one particular clan that wants him out. Well, one particular person that wants him out. And let's just say it's not looking good. I mean, what were you planning to do with the information I was going to give you on this individual, if you don't mind me asking?
I want to know why.
You want to know why he's doing what he's doing?
Mm-hmm.
Mm. Were you planning on going?
Is not there. If the answer is not in what you have for me, then it's in his house, probably. And that's where I'm going next.
All right. Well, why don't we make this official business then? I mean, you are a treasure hunter. And I am allowed to give you a contract, even though you are not within our cell. But I don't necessarily want him assassinated yet. I think I could get a better price on his head if that happens. But I do have a couple contracts which involve getting things from his house. The stipulations of the contracts do not say that he particular items may be lifted as well. If you know, you see, I mean, they are only looking for one particular item. If this looks like just a general robbery, I don't care, as long as you get this one particular item. If you're interested in going in his house, I would like you to take at least one or two of these contracts. So we like to keep good relations with some of the clansmen in Nortek. So if I send somebody on later and you happen to steal that particular item, it might not look very good that we went in and somebody already stole something. That's happened in the past, and it has sucked. So there are a couple contracts of things we want lifted from the house. Okay. And they're worth a good chunk of change if you're willing to take them on. One second. And you see that he goes under his desk, pulls out three pieces of paper. He puts them in front of you, and he says, "There are three particular items these individuals are looking for. As you know, with treasure hunter contracts, we've already taken our fee of being of the contract being drafted, and we get a cut beyond what you would normally, you know, a cut that they will give to us beyond what is already offered to you. So if you're interested, you're looking at a job that's possibly worth item. If you're ambitious and want to go for all three of these items, you're looking at a job that's possibly 3,000 gold altogether if you want to try to lift all three of these items. One contract is worth 500. The other two are worth, that's worth 150, 1,500, and the other last one is worth 1,000. One item is worth, well, not worth, but the the person is willing to pay 500, another is worth wants to pay 1500 for another item, and another person wants to pay 1000 for the last item.
I can probably grab all three. All
right. You might need a little help. His how heavily guarded was his last estate? I know he has three, and one hand did say you were in Tedum. Not too long ago.
Not too heavily. I've got some friends with me who can help with that.
All right. You probably will need them because I've sent one person to scout the area, and that person no longer has his left thumb. So the area is, well, his more valuable rooms will be very heavily trapped.
Okay.
And if you want to look at what items you're lifting, then you're more than welcome to. The 500 gold piece item is a small statue of a, and he shows you the contract. The first item is a small statue of a head. And the individual is, it looks like it is, you know, the picture makes it look like it's rotting, but it's actually a piece of art. It could be an idol missing a left eye. And the client is very, very interested in this particular piece. The other item, the 1500 gold piece item, well, the 1500 gold piece job, is of a orb that is completely crystal, about the size of a dwarven fist, and it has you'll know it when you see it. It is of, they have a red crystal glowing inside, so it's an orb with a red crystal. And the last item is a little more tricky. The last item is actually not an item, it's a person. It's a person. And this is based mostly on a rumor, but we think that rumor may be true. A while back, a shoemaker had lost his daughter. His daughter is in her about to bloom into an adult. So she's a teenager, adolescent, about to bloom into an adult. She has been missing for 2 weeks now. This individual is pretty much giving up his life savings to make sure of her safe return. We believe she is currently in the Steelforge estate. We don't know what's going on with her, though. We've a couple of networks what seem to be homeless and beggars outside that have seen her being taken to his estate here. Her name is... Her name is Vonda Iron Axe. And he gives you a general description of her. She has blonde hair, very long past her shoulders. She is a dwarf. She is, you know, a very, you know, very pretty looking woman. No scarring, you know, we don't know what he wants with her. But that was, this contract I, you know, just got and finished documenting. But he would like her safe return as soon as possible. If she is not alive, the amount is the same.
Okay. Okay.
And he had, Iron Axe had made his name public to us. So if you wanted to get some more information on her. He is also located in the trade ward as well. He had made an attempt to try to get his daughter back, but since the Steelford name does carry some weight in the city, a commoner like him, it's hard to get anything done. That's why he looked to us.
Right. Okay.
All right.
So I have descriptions of all of them. I have cash. I need one or two. I'd like one or two things before I try this.
Okay.
You. Do you have any glass cutting tools? The quiet kind.
We can provide some of those for you. We have. If you visit the quartermaster, Fanra Thunderheart is our quartermaster. You'll find her in the west room. If you cross the common room once you come in, she can probably provide you some tools. You'll have to buy them, of course, but she can probably provide you some very quiet glass cutting tools if need be.
Okay. And then I had a couple of things I wanted to tell you as well.
Mm-hmm.
One of the dwarves on the upper levels, one of the dwarves in the merchant district has a mask, a very old mask, that could be sold for a great deal of money to the right collector. I know the name of somebody who he's planning to sell it to soon. If you wanted to, you could get in there and take it from him and sell it yourself.
Hmm. That's very good information.
Probably 3,000 gold or so, at least.
Nice chunk of change. I'll have Gimdel look into it.
I'll give you the name of the buyer in exchange for a little finder's fee.
Make a persuasion check.
Did I beat him?
Dragonbender says, normally I take this, but we've been on the trade ward's shit list as of late, so I probably will have to decline.
Okay.
I don't really want to. I mean, we're trying to keep low, you know. Other than dealing with trash like Zaylor, We want to keep the guild's nose clean for a little while because we've had some run-ins in the trade ward there, and it would suck if they knew about this place, so I just want to keep my distance. So I'm sorry, I'll have to turn down this offer.
Okay. No worries. The only reason I mention it is because between Zaylor and the other business our party has in town, I don't think we'll have time to do it ourselves.
Okay. Well, I'll help Gimda keep an eye out, but in the meantime, we might try to pursue this later once the authorities are off our back.
Okay.
But thank you for the offer. Regardless, one-handed to have plenty of good things to say about you.
She always does. And then I have one other quick little question for you.
Mm-hmm.
Do you know anything about whatever happened to the Silver Breeze?
I know of him. You see him just... What happened to him? Like, if he died or, like, where he went?
Yeah. Any of those.
His last... This is just, you know... His last known location from the legends and the rumors... Say that he was on his way to Robur.
Oh.
Yeah. He got wind. His last attempted heist, I heard, was with one of the warlords, with a warlord, who is the ancestor of the current warlords. Apparently he tried to steal something or was attempting to steal something, and that was the last anybody had heard of him. Your best bet to find out would probably be going to Fort Granite. That's the capital of Robur. That was the last known location. That's all I know. I don't know what he was after. I don't know if he was truly killed in Fort Granite, but that was his last known location.
Insight to see if he's telling me the truth or if he's knowingly lying to me.
He seems genuine. I mean, he doesn't seem to. And when you look around his room, there are, you know, the books he does have are on, you know, lore and legends and a couple, you know, obscure pieces of history. He seems genuine.
Okay. Well, with that, that's all I have to ask about.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
All right.
Good.
And please do come again, especially if you find anything else interesting in Steelforge Estates.
Of course.
Remember, I mean, actually, there is one more thing I want to ask you. If you can find anything, any information in the house that connects him with any of his other family members, I have a very, really nice contract that's paying for information on any individuals in his family that is helping Zaylor. That will add possibly another 500 gold if you could find anything relating to any familial help he's getting.
Okay.
I don't, like, the contract was very nonspecific. But if you find anything at all, it may be worth your while.
Okay, sounds good.
All right. Well, hopefully I'll see you soon with the other completed contracts, and yeah, nice doing business with you, Ramas.
Good doing business with you, too.
Alright. Back upstairs, Kasov and Kevmorn, you're drinking your drinks. Kevmorn is currently chugging his bottle instead of just from the cup. After about 30 minutes, the doom song ends. There are a couple silver pieces that are tossed into what look like to be a Robin Hood-style feathered cap the kobold had in front of him. And he, after he finishes his very, very long song, he walks to the bar and starts talking to the female bartender, Gimya, and I need you two to roll perception checks again. Okay, much better this time.
Gotta get some ale in me. Yeah, that's good.
The more I drink, the better I see things.
Maintain my true focus.
Coming through the door, you see a very familiar looking gnome, Kasov. It's Kendred, and he enters the inn and makes a beeline for your table. He spotted you as soon as he walked in. I mean, he critically rolled his perception. And he has a big smile on his face. He has a small stack of tomes, probably half as long as he is. And he starts heading over to you guys, and he's like, "Ah, Kasov, it's good to see you. And he motions to an empty spot at your table. Is it okay if I join you and your very tall friend?"
I point to the empty space and say, "Sure, Kendred, have a seat."
Excellent. My legs are tired. Carrying this big stack.
I say, "Oh, okay, what have you got here?"
"Well, you remember that gold dragon I was telling you about?"
"Yes."
My brain started running around like a hamster on a wheel, and I wanted to do some more research on gold dragon, so I decided to take a walk at the library, and then I got hungry, and then I kind of forgot where I was, and then I saw this inn, and I figured I could get food here. Even though it looks a little unkept. And here I am. And you happen to be here. And I'm being so rude. My name is, as Kasov said, my name is Kendred. I am the high priest of the Temple of Ioun here in Nortek. Who do I have the pleasure to sitting next to you? As well as, you know, Kasov."
Put my hand out to, like, shake his. And then I'll be like, my giant hand, basically.
Your hand just like engulfs his tiny one. But he's like shaking very enthusiastically.
I'm Kevmorn. Pleased to meet you.
It's pleased to meet you too. Wow. He's like, "So, what are you guys doing in a place like this?"
I say, well, Kevmorn and I are."
"Did you guys get hungry too?"
As I
start drinking the wine again.
"As I believe I mentioned, Kendred, my quest is taking me here. I can't really say much more detail than that."
"Ah, don't worry about it. Don't worry about it. Don't worry about it."
Excellent. But then I motion to Kevmorn and say, "Yeah, I met Kendred over at the Temple of Ioun. He's very enthusiastic about knowledge."
Just out of nowhere, Kendra says, "Hey, Kevmorn, I'm saying that right, right? Have you been inside a purple worm before?"
"I can't say that I've been inside a purple one, no."
"Oh, okay. Damn it. I won't be able to settle that bet. That's okay."
I chuckle and say, "He asks that to everybody."
"No, I just have a..."
"Why?"
So I have a bet with Xerex. He heads the Oak Hall Theater that's nearby, and we're trying to settle a bet. See, I bet that the stomach of a purple worm, as well as an intestine, it's just one long gullet, very similar to the earthworm. Xerex doesn't think so. He believes there is a system of there is a chambered system within the animal. I just want to settle this bet. I mean, it's only 5 gold, but I'm really curious about the internal system of a purple worm."
"Well, I'm sure if we ever come across one, we can carve it up and see, and then report back."
"That would be great. I mean,
if we ever see them." Where would they even live?"
"Well, purple worms often live in... Well, they live deep underground. They're very common in the high mountains here in... well, not very common. They're uncommon in the mountains here. You'll have to go either very deep into the mountain, and then you'll have to make a lot of noise because they find their prey by vibration. Once in a while, we hear reports of them eating giants." No, wait a second. I Your mic kind of just fizzed for a second.
Yeah, so I turned it off quickly because my dog started barking because there was a visitor at the door or something. But yeah, so they're capable of eating giants. In one go, like.
It depends on the size of the purple worm. I mean, I've heard stories of purple worms being like gigantic and being able to swallow a giant. I mean, I don't need a. We don't need unless their digestive system changes as they get older. I never thought of that. Maybe I need to go get more books. Damn it! I may lose this bet.
Well, I mean, technically, you'll both be right if it changes.
Yeah, I guess. I tried asking Helka, but she won't tell me anything.
Who's Helka?
Oh, you should meet Helka. Helka, she runs a house of fortune. So she's a fortune teller. She's this old dwarven woman that lives in, very close by me, actually, over at the lore, at the lore ward, and you know she is very skilled at divination, and she's not a dwarf, she's a human. She's just kind of short. Not as short as me though, but she is a diviner. She doesn't talk to, I mean, she'll read your fortune for a fee, but she doesn't really, other than divining, she doesn't really talk too much. She has a couple sons here, who are fishermen, and spend most of their time at the fish market, fishing by the river. But, you know, she, if you need to know anything in this town, she would be the person to talk to. Even the nobles go and talk to her.
Hmm. Is she good at what she does?
Oh, she's very good at what she does. But she can't tell me about purple worms, though.
Most of the time when I've met someone who say they can tell me the future, would take my gold and then be as ominous as possible. Or rather, as vague as possible, in the sense of, you will have this in your future, nondescript amount of time, nondescript thing, sort of. Is it?
Well, she can tell the future, but we were talking once, and most of the money she makes is from contacting dead relatives and allies. But she doesn't do it that often. She can't do it. I think she told me. See, I tried to talk to my great grandfather once because he knew something that I didn't, so I wanted to know about it. And she said she was tapped out for the week, so I had to go. I had to make an appointment in advance with her a couple weeks later. My great grandfather didn't have much to say though. But she can't talk to the dead. I mean, that's her thing. That's what most people book her in advance for, but minor fortune telling, yeah, she could probably tell you what's what.
Sounds like fun.
Mm-hmm. It is an interesting thing. I mean, I've dabbled in some of the divination magic myself. Of course, as a follower of Ioun, that is a very good thing to know. Wouldn't you agree?
Probably.
Cool.
Ramas, at this point, you probably, you know, come back upstairs after getting what info and contracts you can. And
glass cutters.
And glass cutters. Mark down probably 10 gold off from the quartermaster. And she gave you some sharpening tools as well, just in case, you know, they wear down a bit. They're very nice, a very nice set. And when you come back upstairs, you see that there is a gnome sitting where Kasov and Kevmorn are, and waving his hands, talking very enthusiastically, with a giant stack of books next to him. you see a kobold at the bar, you know, drinking, talking to the female bartender there, you know, going on his own tangent. Yeah.
I'm going to just kind of wave at Kevmorn and Kasov, be like, and try not to be noticed by the weird guy with all the books.
Yeah, make a perception check, you guys. You two see Ramas, you know, at the other end of the room, kind of trying to get your attention as Kendred continues to go on and on and on. This time, he is talking about Durgar and Boulettes. For some reason, he got into that subject for just continually talking.
Well, as a dwarf, I have a very negative opinion of Durgar, so I'm probably joining in on that. But when I notice Ramas, I'll probably I'm gonna try to tell Kevmorn to go over to Ramas and see what he wants.
I'm just trying to think of an amazing excuse. Give me a moment. I need more wine. I'll be right back. Okay. And then I leave and like just literally just stand up, walk towards Ramas. no smoothness to it. Just
because you know,
I stand up, the chair even goes like.
Clearly, I'm the one to go see if you need wine.
Even though there's like half a bowl left, or so.
Yeah.
Yeah. Kendra doesn't really seem to notice, and Kasov and Kendra begin an intense discussion on Duergard society.
So, Kevmorn. I found Zaylor, and I have some stuff about him, and he might have a hostage, which is bad. We should totally go do something about that.
I narrow my eyes at Ramas, and I want to insight check him, because I don't feel like he's telling me everything.
Yeah, sure, go ahead.
I believe him. You're right. I'm proud of you, you're making, making leaps
of roll. Just roll, I just want to see the right thing. Roll persuasion, and not, like...
My persuasion... I have a +6 for...
You're fine. Yeah, Ramas seems truthful. And doesn't seem to hold anything.
I'm proud of you, Ramas. You're finally making progress with your whole secrets and lying and thievery. You're actually able to help people for once.
I always help people. Helping people is fun.
Helping yourself doesn't count, Ramas.
I help, like, Hwinnil sometimes, and Kasov, and me, and Kasov, and then
Alright, so when do you think we should go? And, I mean, I assume you know, like, all the way there, how we're getting into this, wherever it is.
I assume
you do know where we have to go, right?
Yeah, I assume that there's like his address or something in the papers he gave me.
Oh yeah, his estate is in the trade war in the residential area. It's probably not too hard to find.
Okay. So I'm just gonna have to sweep the whole house, aren't I? We're just gonna have to sweep the whole house.
Brilliant plan. We send you in first, and you be stealthy like, and then. You know, if anything goes wrong, you just shout out a word and we'll come running.
The word will be pineapple. We still have those sending stones.
Too. Okay.
Yeah.
Alright.
That's a good point. We still have those and they still work.
Actually, Whittle's not here, so she can't argue when I ask her for a pass without trace spell. Which would probably be helpful for all of us. But...
That's true. She will have to go... I mean, if you want it, then... Don't you have to stay within, like... Hold on. Pass without trace. Plants. Pass without trace. 1 hour. Shall raise you. She'll have to go with you because you have to be within 30 feet of her.
I mean, she has okay dex and, you know, plus 10 helps.
Mm-hmm.
But, yeah, sure. I mean, she can also just, like, wild shape or something if she has to, but...
Yeah, I mean, if she can maintain concentration up to an hour, yeah. Yeah.
I mean, the other option is I just open the door and we all open the front door and we all go in together.
I mean, I'm not saying I'm not the stealthiest person. And then at that point, I just like hit my metal gauntlet on my metal armor. I was like, but this makes a lot of noise.
That's why Winnow is going to be all magical.
No amount of magic can stop this much noise. And I just start, like, jingling it. Lift my arms up and down repeatedly, just making metal clank noises.
You'll be the cavalry, then.
I can't ride a horse.
You're a paladin. How can you not ride a horse? I thought all paladins rode horses. You know, riding around on their high horses, smiting the... people who are below them.
Right, that right there, that's classic.
Because they're on such high horses, right?
I haven't smited anyone today yet, Ramas, but...
That's because you're not on a horse! Keep up! You need to get a horse.
Tell you what, get me a horse and I'll smite you with it. With the horse. Not any other magical... With the actual horse. I'll use the horse as a smiting tool, Ramas.
That sounds painful.
Anyway. Anyhow. Probably is. So we're just going in to rescue a hostage. I mean... Who is this person? Are they important to someone, or...?
They're someone's daughter.
Are they important to someone who will pay?
Of course.
I mean, I don't mind helping for free. It's just, that doesn't keep people fed.
They're willing to pay.
I thought so. And I look around, like I'm looking around the shape, you know, this thievery place, and like, someone's always willing to pay.
Wow.
What does that even mean? I don't know.
Alright. Do we want to do
should we rescue Kasov right now? I mean, he looks quite happy where he is. I mean, are they still talking? Just like...
Kasov, very enthusiastic. If Kasov isn't talking, Kendred is still fucking talking. this time the conversation has shifted from Duergar to Beholders.
Oh, that's fun.
He looks like he's enjoying himself. Should we just go on our own and do this, or... I mean...
Sure.
I mean... Wait, what? No, we need him. Things go really badly, we need him.
I'll, like, wave at Kasov and be like...
subtle hand motions, like, pointing to the door.
Yeah, you slowly walk. Kasov, you see this...
Okay, I say to Kendred, this has been really, really interesting, and I'd like to discuss more, but unfortunately my quest is taking me away.
Oh, no worries. Were you going to finish that? And he points to your pie, shepherd's pie.
I say, it was... Did I think it tasted good or not?
It was alright. I mean, it's not the best you've had, but It's not the worst.
Okay, I say. Well, it was pretty good. Sure, you can have it, and I push that over to him, and I quickly down the rest of my ale and say that, and the ale here is good too.
Okay, I will keep that in mind. You have fun with whatever you're doing. You see, he takes out the thickest tome from his book pile. He puts it in front of him and starts cracking it open, and you know, starts scanning things. He has a little stack of parchment on the side, takes out a quill and starts jotting down notes. And every once in a while, you hear him mutter to himself, maybe if they're dragon blood might work. How am I going to get dragon blood? Huh. Oh, well. Beholder eye stalks. And he just, you know, has at least tuned you out at this point.
Okay.
1 second. Just be right back.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Yep, so I stand up and take my leave.
Okay.
And walk over to Ramas, and I guess I ask what's going on.
We're gonna go save someone's daughter from the evil guy from Tedum.
Okay. Yes, I think I sort of infer that he's probably talking about Zaylor.
Probably. It's Ramas.
Yep. If he's the bad guy from Tedum, then he's probably...
Unless he means the mummy, but you guys already took care of that.
That's okay. The Rockbiter clan, that thing is on my mind. The metal.
Mm.
The artifact. That's on my mind, so... So I would probably think of that.
Okay.
Okay, very well. Very well. What kind of information do you have? Do you have any leads on where to go?
I have where his house is.
That's a good lead. Okay. that would be adequate. All right. So when would you like to go?
Do we want to do this, or do we want to do that thing that Hwinnil found with the tombs first, or do we want to do Florgarin's thing with the Paladin of Moradin?
That was Kevmorn's thing, actually.
Kevmorn's thing, sorry.
The iron tomb?
Yep, the iron tomb.
Yeah, but Hwinnil saw some sketchy people going into a different tomb. His name I do not recall.
Okay, well...
The plan for both of them is send me in alone and have me yell pineapple if something goes wrong, but...
Understood. I guess... Is Hwinnil here with us? Sort of...
Hwinnil probably is back at the Black Cat Inn. Probably was hanging out with Grim and Griff and Wildbeak and Orange Cat and with her whole menagerie of animals. So you can go grab her if you want.
Okay. I would say that we might want to check in with her to see how urgent things seem on what she's what she found out about with the Black Crypt. So yeah, we can maybe check in with Hwinnil to see about which things are top priority and which thing is urgent. And same with Kevmorn when he comes back.
Whenever he comes back.
Yep, but right. I'm open for any of those. How high a priority? Although if we were talking about a kidnapping of a young girl.
But somebody who we know does awful things to young girls and boys.
That might be a little more urgent. So it's up to you, Ramas. It sounds like the kidnapping might be more urgent because those crypts have been sketchy and haunted for a while, probably.
True.
What's one more day? What's one more day or a few more hours? So,
okay.
Yep, unless you want to go and talk to Hwinnil, I'm okay with joining you to stop the kid, to save the kidnapped person.
Of course. All right.
Okay.
Let's do that then.
Okay. Cool. Cool. So we're gonna we're not gonna bother Hwinnil.
Nah, not yet.
We'll just find the place. So, lead the way.
All right. I will lead them to his home.
Okay.
As we're going, I'll kind of brief them on what exactly we're looking for. So we're looking for the girl. I'll give them her name and description.
Okay.
I'll also tell them that we're looking for anything that describes why Zaylor's doing all this shit. Anything that could prove familial connections to, or anything that could prove that the rest of his family is supporting him.
Mm-hmm.
And anything, I'll describe the other artifacts as well that I have contracts for, but I'm going to spin them as awful blood magic artifacts.
Okay. How does this sound to you, Kasov?
Yeah.
Typical.
Okay. Typical.
I'm not too phased by it, I guess.
Okay. All right. So, Ramas leads you through the trade ward. I mean, there's a couple people you have to ask and stuff for directions how to get to the residential district, but it's not really too hard to find. As you walk, most of the houses here are uniform in structure. I mean, you do see the black stone necropolis, you know, types of structure and mausoleums intertwined with the more blocky dwarven architecture. And most of the houses are here because, you know, you are literally in a mountain. Is, you know, this foliage is sparse. What like plant life you do see usually come in the form of glowing fungi, lichen. Once in a while, you will see some plant life that you're familiar with above ground, except they're being their light is being supplemented by magical means, and the ones that do have those magical means look to be on the more wealthier side. When you get to Steelforge's estate, it appears to be a three-floored building with a flat roof. There are two guards in front of the gate. And then it is about, it looks like 50 feet from the gate to his home. And there's just a simple stone path that goes up to the front door. But, you know, in the middle of the courtyard area, there looks to be a stable of some kind, a very large stable. And there is a nice... tall iron fence that surrounds the perimeter.
Okay. So first obstacle, I guess, is the fence.
What did you say, Ramas?
First obstacle is the fence, I guess.
So you want to just go around and check out the fence?
Are there any sort of trappy stuff on the fence, or?
The fence appears to be about 30 feet tall. There is like a 10-foot blocks of stone, and then the fence comes up. And there's spikes at the top of the fence. It doesn't appear that the fence is Why don't you roll me... So you're looking to see if the fence is trapped. Roll me an investigation.
That's going to go well.
I can
well.
Climb this easily.
This fence does not appear to have been trapped. I mean, okay. It might be a little hard to get over since it's very tall. And there appears to be... there appear to be guards at intervals. However, none of them had gone by you while you were checking out the fence because percentage rolls suck. But you do notice that there are more people here than there were at Zaylor's previous estate.
Okay. That's annoying. Are there any, how long would I have if I chose to climb the fence? Is there, a window where there are no guards looking at certain spots? Or...
So, you have two guards in the front. It appears to be there is a patrol that comes... So, it's like a square rectangular... the fence is more square than rectangular. So there appears to be two guards that appear to have start on opposite ends, and they both kind of patrol around the inside of the fence. So you have two different individuals doing that. There are two in the front of the gate. As far as you can tell, looking at the house to see if there's any, are there any guards staffed, in front of the windows, you do get glimpses of people walking by the windows. Not too much activity in the house. There are a couple rooms that are lit. Only about maybe less than a fourth of them are lit. It is getting a little darker now, so people may be having supper and preparing to retire for the night. Looks like four active guards. You're not sure about inside the house, though.
Okay. Yeah, so there should be a spot where I can just... Are there any, directly on the gate? Can I just open the gate?
Well, the entrance to the gate, there are two guards outside.
Okay. All right. Do you guys have any ideas?
Most of them involve a water balloon, a donkey, and a mop. Unfortunately, I don't have access to any of those things, so no, I don't think I can get us in here.
Let's see.
I mean, do you have any, smoke bombs, Ramas?
I have regular bombs.
No.
Hold on, yes.
No.
This is a tough one.
What we could do if we had the frickin',
What if we just lure the guards away from the front somehow?
That's a good suggestion.
Kevmorn, you're loud.
Thank you for noticing. I try.
Wait, I think Ramas has a point. We could connect your loudness to a distraction to get the guards away. Are you connecting the dots here?
I could run up and punch one of them and run away, but... I don't think that would work well.
No, true. And also, it would be nice if we could all three of us get in.
Apparently.
Yes.
I mean, what's opposite the gate? On the way to the house, but say if you were walking out of
in the
that
back
house.
Say
if you're walking out of that house, where the guards are facing, basically. I assume if they're looking outwards towards.
Alright, so the two guards in front, and then you have the house. There appear, like, are you looking at the house, or do you want to see, like, what's on the other side of, like, not the front of the house with the gate, but, like, on the further side where the other, where the fencing is?
No, like, so if you're walking out of the house up to the gate,
mm-hmm.
like, you're actually in the house, and then you, like, go out of the house up to the gate, what would you see looking out the gate?
Well, you see the stable.
Is that at, what? That's outside the gate, the fence.
Well, okay. So, you know, it'd be better if I drew it. So, oh, well, I could just draw this. It'll be a very crude picture, but
that's fine.
You guys are here. Alright. So, and this is not the scale, this is just, you know, I'm drawing freehand. So, house is right here. Fencing is around the house. Gate is right there with the two guards. So, guard one, guard two. You have a patrolling guard. Well, he's inside, sorry. Patrolling guard here, going around the perimeter of the house. You have the stable that is right here. It's not as big as the house. You have the stable that's right there. And I can't spell stable with this thing. There's the path. There appears to be another path in the back that goes this way. There is actually a smaller entrance on the other side as well, but there appears to be a very, very large heavy padlock on that entrance. That's roughly what the house looks like. And this is a 3-4 house, so three floors.
So what would be, like, over here? If I ping it on the...
Oh!
Like in...
Over there?
Yeah.
Over there, so there is a street that is over here. And there's another house, very similar, but probably not as large. Fencing on the other side.
I look to the two and I'm like, well, I have an idea, but you guys really won't like it. But it's like one of the best distraction things that anyone would want. Or like when someone sees it, they like instinctually go towards it. And then I point to the house and go, we can light that house on fire.
Aren't the houses here made of stone?
Yes, they are. They are made of stone.
No, I didn't.
I don't think we can light a stone house on fire.
What about the roof? Is that made of stone, or is that straw, or something?
The roof appears to be made out of slate. They lose a lot of rocks in the mountain.
It's like it's like they have access to high-quality stone or something. How could they get this here? How explosive are your grenades, Ramas?
I don't know. How explosive are they?
They're kind of explosive. I mean, if you throw one against the house, you think you can make a small hole in it. I mean, not like a you know, it goes right through, but you know, there'll be some impact, there'll be some loose stone.
Damn.
But you do have more than one.
Yes.
So, if you threw a couple, you might, you know, there might be a hole that forms or a tiny crater.
Yeah, I could start hucking them at Sailor's house and see what happens.
That's a possibility.
Ooh, you know what?
Would you
okay.
throw them and then hide and run back to the front with us and then we'd all go in?
Here's an idea. So behind the... Do the guards go behind the stable?
They do not.
Okay. So there's no guards up on the fence there. So what we can do is we can go over to, like, here. It's out of view of the guards from the front. The guards going around here don't go back there. So we can go in there. I can put a grappling hook on top of the fence. We can climb that, end up behind the stable, and hide there.
Point out that there's probably no way I can climb that fence.
That's why I have a grappling hook and a rope.
I would like to point out that the grappling hook and rope would still probably not allow me to climb up a fence like that.
I have 100 feet of rope. I can double braid it for you.
That might work.
Yes.
Alternatively, I could... Oh, wait, no, I don't have my chain armor. I exchanged that. Yeah, okay, this is going to be difficult. It's a good plan, though. I like that one. That
yeah. Work. So let's do that.
Okay.
I don't want to check how much weight rope can support. I'll do that. Do you need me to roll stealth in the meantime, though?
Yes, I do need you to roll stealth.
Okay.
Do we all need to, or just Tim?
Is he the only one that's going up first?
No, everybody's coming up with me.
Then everybody has to roll stealth.
Oh, this is going to be fun.
Oh,
I'm already bad at those. Plus, I get disadvantage thanks to plate mail.
But, like, we're out of view from everybody already.
True. How tall is that? How tall is that fence?
30 feet.
30 feet, I think. Alright, stealth.
Oh, shit.
No, that's bad. Disadvantage.
Oh, shit. We're out of view of everybody, though. That's why we picked this spot.
Yeah, I'll just hear some weird clinking.
So if we're out of view of everybody already, can we not turn that into some form of advantage?
Well, when that happens, Ramas, I need everybody to roll perception checks.
Holy shit!
Wow! Okay!
Oh wow, look at that. Double net 20.
So Kevmorn, as you are trying to stealth your way up to the fence, you hear a voice say, "Hey, I think I heard something over here." And another voice is like, "Are you sure?" And it's like, "I'm gonna go check it out." So there are currently a set of footsteps heading in your direction.
Ramas, quick, throw me one of your grenades! Now! Ramas, fucking give me your grenade!
Wait, is Kevmorn... Which side of the fence is Kevmorn on right now?
I'm, like, hanging off a rope, I thought.
You guys are just getting to, like, that side of the fence, and...
So, which way do we hear it coming from?
You hear it coming from the front.
So, Ramas, either give me a fire grenade or throw it in that direction so they go that way instead.
I don't
Why
think...
are you debating this?
You got 5 seconds.
I don't think that's a good idea. Shit.
I would like to use...
I pull out my poison dagger and get ready for him to come around the corner.
Okay.
We're gonna die.
All right, so
when I see him do that, I draw my warhammer.
Okay. So a couple seconds later, there is this dwarf in, you know, in splint mail, walks up, hammers out. He has a shield. He's like, "Hey, what are you guys doing here?"
Can he see us?
I think if he walked around a corner, he could.
Yeah, he walked around the corner, so he's right here currently. Let me get a token.
Oh, wait, so are we on the opposite side of the fence to him?
No, you didn't even tie the rope yet.
Oh, so it's just Ramas up there.
Damn it, Kevmorn.
So it's just me and Cass over here, and then Ramas is at the top.
I'm hiding somewhere.
He's hiding.
I was going to say, we just saw someone go... We're not even inside yet. Me and my friend here, and I'm pointing to Kasov, and I'm like, we just saw someone
go in, like, just scale that wall and go inside there. We were on our way to the Temple of Ioun. We're shit.
He's nodding.
Is
me nodding helping?
Ooh, not bad.
Okay, so you see the guard's eyes widen. It's like, what did he look like? He over the fence, like right here, right now.
Just he somehow like he just literally scaled it with ease. He went around the back somewhere and like around, and I point to behind the house, like, you know, diagonally,
yeah,
like this way. And I'm just like, yeah, he just like literally just over there. He was like, he had shortish black scruffy hair. He was wearing mostly black clothing as well, like trying to be, I assume, stealthy.
Shit.
That's when me and my friend just ran up and we were trying to, like, we were about to say stop, but then he just sort of, he must have vanished around the corner or something.
Shit, thanks. Dagon! Dagon! And you hear a voice says, what? We might have a burglar! Get to the back of the house! Get the others! And you see him rush back to the front of the gate, and you guys can hear two sets of heavy footsteps beeline it past the gate door, well, the entrance, and there are two more voices that go towards the back of the house.
Okay.
Holy shit, Kevmorn.
He rolled a 7 for his insight.
And then, like, I start pulling Cass. I'm like, come on, quick, while they're away from the main gate.
I'm so proud of you right now.
Well, yeah. I'm a sneaky, sneaky, deceptive paladin. I'm actually not a paladin, guys.
You deceived us.
Actually a bard. I don't want to say anything, but...
Alright,
yeah, let's get in through the gate. I got a good look at the guy's face while I was in there, right? Well, I was hiding.
Decent look.
Okay. Enough to disguise myself as him.
Okay. Of course.
I'm not going to disguise myself yet, but...
Alright, so you guys are going into through the gate entrance. Where are you guys headed? Are you guys to the house, or are you headed to the stable?
The front door.
Alright.
It's kind of in badly, guys. I mean, we got this.
I would actually like to...
Oh, no.
...cut it here. Because I got a message from Hwinnil, and... He's dealing with some stuff right now, so... Okay. And right. Forgrin's also away, and... something's happening outside, and...
It's the cats.
That sounds good.
Yeah, so I'm really sorry for cutting it short today.
That's fine.
Hopefully Toby and Ezra will be back, and I'll just somehow work them into this. They were following you, and you guys didn't know it.
Oh, yeah, totally.
I was thinking, like, the last time I rolled a deception roll, that was when I was convincing everyone that the thing I had to do to get the armor was, like, really safe and okay and completely fine, and I rolled a nat 20 on that,
mm-hmm.
and I've rolled 17 on this now. Like, out of the two rolls I've rolled, they're both really high.
Mm-hmm.
I'm very deceptive, apparently.
Yeah, I mean...
Ramas is fine with this.
Ramas rolled a 1. You rolled a 2. So it was.
I mean, a 1.
I just like that Ramas rolled a 1 and he turned it into a 12, though, because that's still pretty good.
20 dex and expertise in stealth, man.
It's ridiculous.
Rogues, that's what they're good at.
He's just like, oh, you know, you're still invisible. I know you're there, but they can't see you.
Exactly.
See that. All right. We will be playing on the 18th. The 18th. Yeah, that's...
Looks good to me.
All right. Yeah, that sounds good. Yeah, again, sorry it's so short, but I... why does everything happen at once? All right, I'll give you XP later. I'll put that in my notes.
That's
give
fine.
XP later.
Just, yeah, I'll borrow them or something.
All right.
Have a good time at the party.
All right, hope thanks. All
enjoy.
All right, thanks, guys. I'll see you in 2 weeks.
Yep,
see you soon.
Bye-bye.